Last week, we started an English version of our Learn the Hymn Book, and this has been a very fun learning curve, I guess, for me. As I searched through the hymn book and I searched through our services and I searched through all of the audio tracks that we have, and I found one that fits perfectly with the theme for this month, hope and being anchored to hope, being anchored to Christ and abiding in Him so that He is our refuge and our shelter. So we are going to sing hymn number 2, Abide With Me. So if you have your hymn books, go ahead and turn to number 2. If not, the lyrics will be displayed here. So Abide With Me. Praise the Lord. This last verse Hold thou thy cross before my closing eyes, shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning break and earth's vain shadows flee. In life, in death, Lord, abide with me. That is our hope. When we close our eyes for the last time, when we take our last breath, the next moment we will know is we will be abiding physically with the Lord in heaven for eternity. And that is a great hope, a hope for the future, a hope that the trials and the struggles and the storms of this life, they're not forever. We have a hope that we can look forward to in heaven with Christ. And that to me brings me so much peace and so much comfort, knowing that we are going to abide with him, not just here, but for eternity. What does the word abide mean? Abide means to accept or to act in accordance with a rule or decision or even a recommendation. Is to obey, to observe, to follow, to keep to or conform to. We continue with the Lord and we remain and we hold on to him. So to abide in Christ means to intentionally remain in an ever-growing relationship with him. And that relationship transforms our character so that we can be more like him. It means that we are not giving up, but we are continuing on despite our doubts or our hardships. So in John 16, verse 4 and 5 says, abide in me and I in you. As the branches cannot bear fruit of its own unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, we can do nothing. Apart from Jesus, we can't do anything. If we are not secure in him, if we are not abiding in him, if we are not these synonyms, obeying him, following him, conforming to him, holding on to him, we can bear no fruit. We are going to have a worship song before we get into our Bible study, The Hope Part 2 today. This song is an invitation to come just as you are. Maybe you find yourself right now struggling. Maybe your anchor is not very firm. Maybe you are just learning how to abide in Christ. You are just learning who Christ is, who God is. You're a baby Christian. Or maybe you're a career Christian who has been struggling with doubts, that the storm around you has shaken your faith more than you thought possible. The invitation today is to come just as you are. You can have a fresh start. God does not want you to get it together before you come to the cross. He wants to meet you where you are right now in this day, in this moment. If you find yourself that you are a hot mess, come just as you are right now. Worship together. Come just as you are. Hear the Spirit call.
Come just as you are. The Spirit calls. Come just as you are.
Amen. It always puts that knot in my throat and tears in my eyes when we have an invitation from the Holy Spirit to come wherever we are right now, whatever mess we have gotten ourselves into, no matter how faithful we have been, that the Holy Spirit is constantly calling us to come to Him, to find refuge in Him. We can come and have life forevermore in Him. We are going to ask our brother Ezekias to have a prayer for the Bible study, Hope Part 2. So if he can unmute his mic.
Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, in this moment I come before you, Lord, and I thank you for this opportunity that you give all of us to be here, listening to your word, listening to the songs of worship, and giving us hope as well, Lord. I ask you, Lord, that you forgive my sins or anything that I have done that hasn't been pleasant before you, Lord. I ask you that by the blood of Jesus Christ, you wash me clean, Lord, and listen to my prayer. I ask you, Lord, in this moment that you bless everyone that is present and that is ready, Lord, to listen to the word that Lisa is going to bring. I also ask you that you allow our hearts, our minds, and our entire selves to be open ground, Lord, to be ready to receive your word, Lord, that we can remember that the hope that we listen to is not from the world, but from you, Lord. I ask you that you use Lisa and her words, Lord, that it can be your Holy Spirit speaking, not her, Lord. Give her thoughts, give her the words, give her everything that you know that every one of us needs, Lord, and help us all to be grateful for everything that you give us this day and always, Lord. In Jesus' name, and I thank you for everything. Amen. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. Hope, the anchor for the soul. That is the title of the Bible study that we started last week, and we are going to continue this week. Last week, we got into some of the differences between hope and faith. We talked that hope was an assured promise, whereas faith is the acting out of that promise. Faith is really hope put into action. But there are similarities between hope and faith. Hope and faith are integral to salvation. Romans 8:24 and Ephesians 2:8 says this: in this hope we are saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and is not of ourselves. It is a gift of God. So hope, we have the hope of salvation, and grace through faith we have for salvation. So we see that hope is integral for salvation. There are also Christian virtues. 1 Thessalonians 5:8 says, Since we belong to that day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. So these are part of our Christian virtues: faith, self-control, love, and hope. Faith and hope also involves the unseen. Romans 8:24. In this hope we are saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? And then 2 Corinthians 5:7, we live by faith, not by sight. Faith and hope, it is not something that you can look out your bedroom window and find. You cannot see it. It is something that is a part of you. It is the unseen. And then hope and faith both require trust. Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. To the man who does not work, but trusts God who justifies the wicked, his faith is credited as righteousness. So faith and hope both require of us our trust. And then lastly, faith and hope both please the Lord. The Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Your faith and hope are in God. 1 Peter 1:21. But let's talk a little bit about our hope when it is misplaced. Again, I invite you guys to use the chat box to ask any questions or to make any comments. I'm going to be monitoring this chat box so that we can have a little bit of a discussion. Being mindful of the time, we are going to end on time today at 11 o'clock so that we can prepare for our Spanish 11:30 service. So use the chat box. Bring your comments, bring your questions there in that box. Misplaced hope. This is going to most likely touch a little bit of a nerve in some of us, because when we have misplaced hope, we have a lot of discouragement. Misplaced hope can bring a lot of havoc to our lives. So let's get an idea here. We're using anchor as our analogy. So let's look at the different types of anchor. So there is what is called a launch anchor, right? And our launch anchor is dropped in the bay, and it's to keep our ship in place for a very short time. They do not use this very often. It is a quick anchor that you just drop and then you keep moving. All right. The working anchor is a ship's main anchor. And then the storm anchors are placed at the bow and the stern of the ships. They are at the front and at the back of the ship, and they're put out when the ship encounters severe storms. So anchors come in all different sizes and shapes and weights, and they're used to stabilize the ship in the different situations that they find themselves in. So when they're used properly, a relatively small anchor will successfully stabilize a large ship. For example, a 45-pound anchor can be used to stabilize a 4,000-pound ship. Therefore, each anchor must be chosen based on the size and weight of the ship, as well as on the anticipated weather or water bottom. So typically, ships set sail with different types of anchors on board. though terminology differs from place to place or from person to person, some have referred to the three anchors as these: the launch, working, and storm. We all need the storm anchor for our lives, primarily because at different times we will be going through a different storm, or coming out of a storm, or finding ourselves in the throes of a storm. When you have an anchored life, a life anchored in Christ, you cannot be destroyed by a tremendous storm. The Lord will stabilize you until the storm has passed. Proverbs 10:25 says, "When the storm has swept by, the wicked are gone, but the righteous stand firm forever." Amen. So let's talk about our inner feelings of hopelessness. This is what people don't see. This is what many of us are really, really good at hiding. We put that mask on when we go to church and everybody sees this smile, this upbeat person, this person who's talking with everybody. But inside, this is what we sometimes are feeling when we have misplaced hope. Deceived. We've been duped by somebody or disliked. We deem ourselves unwanted by others. Dejected, we're dull, flat, or emotionally stuck. We feel deadened, we feel numbed, we feel lifeless, we feel dry. Downcast, we feel downhearted, assuming that life is never going to change and the situation is never going to change. Or we discount that we have value, that our life has value, or we've been belittled by others and degraded, or we feel detached, we feel discarded by God or separated from others, and we feel doomed, we feel trapped with no way out. But here's the thing, when so many significant people have let us down, when we've been discouraged or betrayed by others that we trust so much, how can I live? How can we live a life with hope at all? When those we look to fail us, when those we look to fall, or we find that they have had struggles that we never thought possible, how can we live in hope? But here is the answer. And the answer is simple. People fail people, but that's all the more reason we need to put our hope in God, who will never fail us. He will be our unshakable rock and refuge. Psalm 62, verses 5 through 7 says this, "Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge." My brothers and sisters, when we look to somebody else for our hope, they eventually will fail us because they are human. They are of a sinful nature. They are going to fail. When we put our hope in other people, in our pastor, in our leaders, in our Sabbath, our Sunday school teachers, when we put our hope in them, looking to them for our spiritual growth, for our refuge, they are going to fail. It is just a matter of time. But putting our hope in God alone, he will never fail us. So there are outer feelings of hopelessness. Sometimes these cannot be hidden from other people, because when we look drained, people can see it, okay? When we look debilitated, we are drowning with exhaustion, or we are depleted of energy and strength. When we are disinterested, we're drifting on a sea of apathy. When we are defeated, we are deadlocked from moving forward, and we feel like a failure. When we're down on life or pessimistic about living, when we feel disconnected or despondent or displaced, when we are distraught, we are driven to end dreams, end emotions, and end life. Those are the things that we can see. But what if we don't see a future for ourselves? How can we go on? Maybe you have found yourself in the past, or you find yourself right now feeling drained or debilitated, disinterested, disgusted, disconnected, displaced, distraught. How can you go on? The answer is this. You can go on because God purposefully created your life. He is always watching over you. And because of his unfailing love, you can always put your hope in the future that he has planned for you. God created you on purpose. You are not an accident. You are not an afterthought. God knit you together in your mother's womb. He knew you from the beginning of time. He wanted you. That's how we can go on, because we can trust that God has a plan for you. You might be feeling dejected and defeated and disconnected from other people. You may be feeling hopeless, like your life cannot go on, but God has a planned purpose for you. The eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love. Put your hope on his unfailing love, and that is how you are going to be able to go on, to move forward from your situation, to move past your sin struggle by trusting in his unfailing love. We have a downward spiral of despair, and this spiral is when we are caught in a life-threatening storm and you feel a foreboding sense of doom, a frightening sense of despair. If you've ever felt hopeless, it's as though you've become like a leaf caught in a whirlpool, spinning, spiraling downward, sucked inside the dark center. Those caught in this ominous vortex can feel like Jonah did, disobedient Jonah, who rebelled against God and caused his own miserable plight. Jonah 2:3 says, "You hurled me into the deep, into the very heart of the seas, and the current swirled about me. All your waves and breakers swept over me." Sometimes when we are in this downward spiral of despair, we feel like we are in that tornado. We feel like we are sucked in and we cannot get out. Do you have disappointment, sadness over unfulfilled expectations, or doubt, distrust in yourself to do what is right? Are you discouraged? You're disheartened with no courage at all to risk anything ever again? Are you disillusioned, disenchanted with life because of broken promises? Or experiencing depression? You have a heavy heart, or disdain, or disunity. You feel divided and confused within yourself. Do you feel disharmony, discord, disagreements with others, or despair, devastating with overwhelming hopelessness? Those feelings, finding yourself experiencing one of those, is how you know that you are in a downward spiral of despair. Jonah was a man called by God to deliver a life-changing message of hope to an enemy nation. Okay? But instead, Jonah refused. He rebelled and he ran to board a ship headed in the opposite direction of where God told him to go. But because of his disobedience, the judgment of God fell upon the ship. And as soon as his shipmates figured this out, they threw him overboard. And Jonah described this life-threatening situation and God's life-saving intervention in Jonah 2, 5 and 6. The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank. The earth beneath barred me in forever. But you brought my life up from the pit, O Lord, my God. My brothers and sisters, we can be drowning in this downward spiral of despair. But God, we can claim this verse, but you brought my life up from the pit. The Lord is there. He is your shelter in that storm. He is your anchor to bring you up out of that pit into an upward spiral of hope. Unlike the anchorless person or a person without an anchor, if you have an anchored life, you will never drown in despair. An anchored life is not at the mercy of chance or circumstance. Swirling currents and pounding waves offer no cause for alarm when you abide in the one who is the master over both the storms and of the sea. When you have Christ as your anchor, rather than drowning in the despair, you are held secure with his hope. Imagine experiencing within minutes the extremes of both emotion, despair and hope. Imagine Jesus' apostles flailing about on a boat in the middle of a storm, fearing for their very lives. How could he possibly sleep, they wonder. Frantically, they call out to Jesus, "Don't you care if we drown?" But what does Mark 4, 39 through 41 say? He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Peace, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." That is our upward spiral of hope, being anchored in Christ. And we know that we are harbored in hope because we have contentment. When you have Christ, you have contentment. You are patient because of God's hope for you. If we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. We have courage, being bold because of God's hope within you. Since we have such hope, We are very bold. We have confidence, being assured because of God's hope within you. You have been my hope, O Sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. We have cheerfulness because we are joyful because of God's hope in us. We have comfort. We are encouraged because of God's unfailing love for us. And we have conviction because being anchored in hope because of God's word within us. And we are Christ-like. We are conformed to the character of Christ because of God's hope for us. Philippians 1:20 says, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now and always Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. Amen. This is a good stopping point as we have less than 10 minutes dedicated for this service. Next week, we are going to talk about the hows and the whys. We're going to talk about the different analogies of the different type of anchors that we talked about today. We're going to talk about what causes our misplaced hope and what we can use as, or what we use as anchors that fail us from day to day. And we're going to be looking at God's will. We talked today about our misplaced hope, about feelings of hopelessness. We talked a little bit about, we touched on last week about when we feel hopeless, a lot of times that drives us to have the thoughts or feelings of wanting to end our own life, because death is the only solution to our situation that we see. And as Christians, you know, we always say, oh, you're a Christian, you shouldn't think about suicide, you shouldn't feel that way. But let's talk real here. Even as Christians, we can feel hopeless when we take ourselves away from the anchor of Christ. And that is normal. Those depressing thoughts, those thoughts of wanting to end our life, wanting to commit suicide, not wanting to be here anymore, they're normal. But those are just feelings. And sometimes feelings can lie. If you are finding yourself in that situation today, that you don't see hope for your situation, you don't see an end to the storm, you cannot see the light that is coming, you feel dark and you're discouraged and you're disconnected, please reach out, talk to somebody, whether Brian, our pastor, call me, talk to me. Give us the opportunity to help you find that anchor once again. Don't allow yourself, don't allow the enemy to make you feel more isolated and alone, because you are not alone. The Heavenly Father is there with you. And he is wanting to be that anchor of hope for you. He is wanting to be your refuge and your shelter. So reach out. Speak your truth to somebody. Bring it out of the darkness. All of these feelings and all of these thoughts, bring it out of the darkness and into the light. Because Satan works in the darkness. And once you bring it to the light, your Heavenly Father will heal those negative feelings. Your Heavenly Father will show you that you are not alone. Amen. We are going to ask our brother and pastor, Brian Garcia, to close us out in prayer.
Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, grateful for this new day that you have given us, this new week. I ask you to forgive me of my sins, Lord. Thank you so much, Lord, for this service that has been of much nourishment and comfort to our spiritual lives, Lord. Let it strengthen our walk with you. Let us strengthen our relationship with you, Lord. Those who are perhaps in despair at this moment or feeling hopeless, please let them reach out to those that can help so that they can be strengthened, Lord. We know that we all face challenges and we all get discouraged and we all get anxious. Let us first of all trust in you and come at your feet, Lord. Put our burden at your feet. Let us have faith that you will help us, Lord. And let us also reach out to those around us, our leaders, our pastors, Lord, so that we can receive the help that we need and we can find the joy that it is to walk in your path, Father. Please help us see that. Let not the devil blind us. Let not the devil discourage us. Let us press forward onward until we obtain salvation when you come in clouds of glory, Father. Please bless each and every one that is here connected to this service today, that they have a blessed week, that you keep them safe from all sickness, from any challenges, Lord, that we can just grab onto your hand, knowing that you're going to guide us wherever we need to go, Lord. Keep us safe and let us remain by your side. All of this, I ask in Jesus' name. And now, may the love of God, the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the company and communion of the Holy Spirit, our great counselor, be with all of his children now and forever. Amen.